And that's focusing on industrial and commercial microgrids. So you maybe remember him. We have invited our lead speaker in this, and that's Jillis Raatschelders, Business Director, Energy Transition at DNV GL. So Jillis, also welcome with us today.
Thank you, Margien.
So, and how are you doing?
Doing good. Yeah. Looking forward to this afternoon.
Yeah, it's great to be here, no?
Definitely.
So if you look back at the 15th of September, our first session where you have a great presentation, what were your conclusions?
I think we got a lot of resonance on the fact that we said, don't only look at the microgrid from the inside perspective, but also look at the outside, what's happening outside of the industry. So yeah. The industry, in our perspective, can really be a pivot in both the electrification, as was mentioned during the island, yeah, and the humanitarian discussions, but also for the entire energy transition. So not only looking at the microgrids, but there are other reasons, other drivers,
yeah,
that could
above
actually,
it or above beside
that,
it,
yeah, and that can actually drive that really, yeah, much forward.
I think that's a conclusion. You make it now, but I think it's for all the sessions, actually.
I think it is, yes. Mm.
So I mentioned also, this is a community, so everybody brings something and also hopefully take something back home. What's it for you today?
If I look at it, first of all, I think what I like to see this afternoon is the panel session.
Yeah.
The three people which were going to join us, I think, will make up for the entire spectrum of commercial and industrial microgrids.
Yeah.
And really looking at the exchange of drivers and what's possible and the lessons learned.
Yeah.
So that's one thing I really like to learn and listen into. And the same, indeed, with the experience we have to see, okay, how can we help each other to move this forward?
Yeah. Well, I'm very curious as well. You invited a great panel as well. So please join me at the table and introduce them to me.
I will. So
Jillis, tell us.
Yeah. There we go. We have two panelists joining us from remote. There, first of all, into the left, we have Petra Piklova. She's managing director of the renewable energy segment at ComAmp, and we'll explain something what they do later on. Second, we have Richard Beekhuis, who's managing director of the energy flexibility solutions at ENGIE. And on the table, we're being joined by Rob Kreiter, who's managing director of the top sector industry, so really looking at the energy transition for the industry.
Yeah.
So we're covering from now to small scale to large scale, from now to the future, yeah, drivers.
So this was in a rocket speed.
Yep.
Let's first maybe go to you, Petra. Can you tell us what's your involvement also with microgrids?
Absolutely. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here, part of the panel discussion, and I'm really looking forward to have interesting discussions with the other panelists. And basically, I'm the renewable energy segment manager in ComUp, and ComUp is the manufacturer of control solutions, not only for hybrid microgrids, of course, but also for other applications within the power generation industry and engine-driven applications. So basically today, I would like to share with you some experience and some lessons learned from case studies and reference projects which we did in the past.
Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks. Shall we do the round for Richard and Rob? And then we've asked Petra to start with the case.
So. Richard, please. I guess you're on mute, or
no? I had to find the unmute button. Yes. Also, pleased to be here. My name is Richard Beekhuis. I work at ENGIE on the field of energy flexibility, which is a broad field, which also is on the industrial side in looking into How can we support businesses to grow also in areas with all kinds of grid constraints? So also in this is maybe a different dimension in the discussion, but a very interesting thing, and also to look into the other questions and solutions and case studies. So
Good, welcome. Yep. And to you, Rob.
And Rob.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me here. I'm responsible for the innovation program for the Dutch process industry, their decarbonization requirements within the National Climate Agreement. One of these solutions is electrification, and the electrification of an industrial plant is an issue in itself, but it's also very much a system issue. Most of the time, technologies are there, but it's much more a question of how do we integrate into the existing energy system, what new infrastructure is needed, what influence will the industrial plant have on its environment. So I will highlight a specific case, and from that specific case, we'll try to zoom out to some of the issues around that. Thanks.
So Jillis, you prepared also some cases for us. Maybe you can take us with you.
Yeah, what I'd like to do in this one-hour session is we start with Petra presenting some of the experiences she has, and then we'll engage in some of the discussions. I think this slide is from Richard. If we can move to the slide from Petra. And then, so we build up the discussion starting from industrial microgrids to from energy communities to large decarbonization. So let's see if we can bring up
the slide
of Petra.
Maybe you can already introduce your slides, Petra. Yeah.
Okay, so I will start to share my screen, or shall the studio will show the slides, because it seems like I cannot do it.
No, the studio will pick up on the slides, Petra. If you if you can start introducing your case, the studio will bring up the slides.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay, so what I have prepared for you is just a very brief intro into two case studies. We basically completed two projects a few years ago. Both of them were on remote locations. One of them was a remote island of Kiribati, and the other one was Peter Virgin Island at the British Virgin, sorry, Peter Island at the British Virgin Islands. And that was a remote resort. And basically both of these sites had challenges with the operational expenses, with the dependence on the fuel, and of course with some environmental issues as well. And that's why both of these, the owners of the sites decided to implement some sort of renewable energy, which would basically enable them to reduce the carbon footprint as well as to reduce the energy independence, or sorry, the energy dependence and the operational expenses. So what basically we were looking into was that on the first island on Kiribati, the load fluctuated quite significantly, and therefore there was not really much of a room to increase the PV penetration too much. That's why the PV installation was quite small. And basically this limited PV penetration means that the capex is quite small. However, the consumer needs to count on the fact that, of course, the operational expenses reduction will be quite limited too. This scenario is the easiest, let's say, easiest case from the control system perspective, because it's not so demanding on keeping the dynamic spinning reserve and things like that. Therefore, this case is quite easy from the technological point of view, or let's say from the integration point of view. Nevertheless, still, as you can see on the slide, hopefully, the saving of the fuel and also the CO2 emissions was quite significant. On the other hand, the Peter Island at the British Virgin Islands, here we had the chance to install a much higher, let's say, wind penetration compared to the installed rated power on the gensets. And that was enabled thanks to the fact that it is a resort and the load had a quite stable consumption. So the issue here or the challenge was with the variable wind output, which was like really, really high. And therefore we had to keep the dynamic spinning reserve on the gensets very high as well. And that, of course, leads to less favorable diesel savings. So in this case, the owner, of course, expected a quite high reduction of the operational expenses. Nevertheless, due to the nature of this, of the wind conditions over there, it was not so easy to achieve it. Nevertheless, just to conclude it, really, these of both of the off-grid projects, I would consider successful because both of them contributed quite significantly to the reduction of the operational expenses and the fuel consumption.
Petra, I know you have prepared slides, but today we're unfortunately unable to show them. For your audience, it's important then to look back because then we try to fix it and you will see also the data because, Petra, you mentioned them, but they're also written on the slide. So that's something for maybe next week.
Petra, you mentioned the key drivers being cost reduction and renewable integration. Were those the two main drivers for the industry to actually move to a local microgrid, or were there other external factors in these cases?
Well, I think in these cases it was more of really the internal factors, because for these off-grid locations, the OPEX reduction, the energy independence, and also the environmental aspects are the main drivers, really. For the resort especially, sometimes guests would like to see that if they're in some nice location, like the British Virgin Islands are, or in Maldives or Seychelles, for example, they would like to see that also the power which they are consuming is coming from the renewable energy resources, if possible, of course. And that's basically why the operators or the owners of the resorts are motivated to invest into some sort of hybrid microgrid, because 100% power supply from renewables sounds, of course, good. It looks good. However, it's not so easy achievable, because if you do not have any battery energy storage in place in the location, then it's, of course, very difficult to achieve it. So some percentage of diesel generators are indeed required over there. And plus, what we face at the beginning with these owners or operators of the site is that they did not have such a big confidence in the technology upfront, and that's why they decided to maybe start with a lower penetration of the renewables and only then gradually actually increase over the next years. And maybe at some point they will also realize that battery energy storage at some form will make sense for them in the future.
That's an interesting remark you make, Petra, because you mentioned that they start with the implementation of renewables, and that later on it might grow. How does that impact the control and the especially looking at the flexibility for the balance on the microgrid?
That's a good question. Thank you for that. Well, of course, from this, like, let's say, long-term point of view, we try to make the system as scalable as possible. So basically, our system, and I would say any control system, would enable, let's say, more renewable energy in the future or some change in the power generation mix. That's for sure, and we design for it. Sometimes it, of course, requires some sort of change in the configuration and the setup of the control system, but it's something what we offer, and we also train our customers to be able to do it themselves. So just to conclude it, basically the system is scalable, so we are able to modify it in the future as per the changing needs of the site, because that's what is happening also quite often. Some of the resorts may just expand, or some of the villages on the islands may expand. The let's say the more home appliances people have access to, their demand grows gradually, and that's basically exactly the moment where people realize that in 5 years' time, sometimes the load or the energy consumption can actually double. And that's why the system needs to be scalable. It needs to be able to be modified in the future, for sure.
And do you mentioned that the public around, do you see other spin-outs or local connection to for example, to the resort, that you see a impact to the surroundings of the availability of that microgrid?
Well, I would say if it's not really island per se, if it's, for example, just a remote village, then of course there are some motives also how to maybe install more microgrids, which can in general basically create, let's say, more robust network of individual microgrids, or if there is a utility which is quite far, nevertheless, they allow these microgrids to be connected, then I would say yes, in some locations, the tendency is there and the utilities welcome it. On the other hand, some utilities just don't like microgrids per se. They just don't like renewable energy because it's intermittent source of power. And it always makes troubles because the utility is responsible for keeping all the parameters, the voltage, the frequency, parameters within certain limits, and then the fluctuations of photovoltaic power plant output or the wind farms, and of course make it more difficult for them. So some of them are not really welcoming microgrids. Nevertheless, I would say the benefit of microgrids is that it can actually be self-independent, sort of. So if it's like too much hurdle for the utility to keep up with the load on the side, the microgrids can just disconnect and run as a, even like a physical, not only electrical island.
Okay. Before we go to Richard to look at his experience, Peter, can you expand a little bit on your experience with the local utilities, how their response is to microgrids?
I would say that the response is differentiate a lot, I would say. Because we are not always in the position where we really deal with the utility, because we are the control system provider, and our customers who actually install the hybrid microgrids are the EPCs or the local system integrators who are dealing with the utilities, which doesn't, of course, however, mean that we do not meet at the utility or with the utilities at all. And basically, some of them even see microgrids as a threat for them. Because in the past, the customers were basically just theirs. The only source of power was the utility. But now it's changing. Now the customer can be just self, almost independent, because if he generates his own power from the local small hybrid microgrid, then he might not need the utility so often. So one of the side is that the utilities are facing the, let's say, the fear of losing the customers. But on the other hand, some of the utilities are more advanced and they see that hybrid microgrids will just inevitably become the new power system of the future. And they are aware of the fact that they would need to cope with it. So I could say that where I saw where I perceived the biggest transition was Australia, where a few years ago we were talking to the utilities just regarding the renewable energy penetration and just connection, not within a hybrid microgrid, but as a standalone photovoltaic power plants. And we were discussing with them the actually protection relays issues, and they were strongly against it. 5 years after that, it has changed a lot, and some of them are sort of welcoming hybrid microgrids too. So I must say that I can see a good trend for the future.
That's good to hear. Richard, as you are involved in one of the project as well here in the Netherlands, I think you prepared that. I would like to propose that you tell us a little bit more about that, because I think it links to this discussion perfectly, yeah. And then we'll continue from there.
Very good. Do you think I will see the slides, or is
we just had your slides up, so they are available. I know, but
they are available. I would like to be on those nice tropical islands I saw. Yeah. We're looking at cases also more in the Netherlands, which is not that tropical, at least this time of the year. We're looking at more industrial sites or sites where businesses are are located and facing connection problems or shortages where the grid operator has not enough power available to support businesses to grow or to expand. So, and this is a situation. I took one in Alphen aan den Rijn, which is a very difficult situation, so to say, very, very challenging. But these kinds of situations are all around in the Netherlands with grid congestion taking place. So we have a situation where we have enough space on the ground, but a very weak grid. And if we look at the next slide, we see a kind of overview of the current situation, seeing one part already pretty full with businesses, and another part which is still a green field, but is should also be filled up with all kinds of businesses. And even the businesses that are already on the existing terrain are facing the congestion issues, not only here, but on the whole area near and around Alphen aan den Rijn. So that's a really challenging question. And if we go to the next slide, we see that the local grids, so the last part, needs to be upgraded or reinforced on many locations, and because of the grid layout, it takes quite some time on different places to make this happen. We are looking at a kind of solutions which we call within NG local energy communities. And this side, not on the consumer side, the customer side, but more on the industrial side, where we're looking at can we make a proposition to these businesses to solve this this issue, because the grid operator is not capable of solving this issue very very quickly, because he needs the time to reinforce the grid, and it needs to happen on a lot of places. So can we come up with a solution in which we can combine both the power profiles in using and also local generation to come to an energy balance which needs to be managed with an energy management system or a microgrid management system, and then being supported with additional PV batteries and local generation. So this is a situation we are looking at, which can be a temporary solution, that's one, but for especially or for instance, Alphen aan den Rijn, we are looking at a situation that even would last after the grid reinforcements by the grid operator are made. So in such a way that we can combine or lower the grid connection fees for the individual businesses in such a way that it becomes interested to work together as a community to solve the energy challenges locally, and thereby solving the short-term problems for the businesses that want to expand or want to grow. And on the other hand, give the other businesses a interesting deal for their energy needs. So that's one of the issues we're facing. So we want to solve the short-term issues and also have a long-term solution. I don't know if we have additional slides. Possibly.
I think they're done.
Yeah.
They're there, yes. So this is this real urgent case. Some of the companies are already expanding and building or extending their current business, and they asked for additional power and they can't get it. So they have an issue in less than a year, and a real issue. So I think this is most of these points I already mentioned. Go to the next slide. So one of the issues we are thinking on, and that's why I picked this case for this discussion, is for instance the fact that we can have the so-called direct line, which is a kind of local grid, but which can solve these kinds of problems by creating a kind of local grid behind the transformer of the grid operator. We have more freedom there. We can have different consumers on this direct line. But from the legislation, there are very strict rules about how this direct line can be used. And I think that is one of the things which is the challenging thing to solve the congestion and energy problem for the businesses, is that the legislation now is constraining or hindering efficient and easy solutions. So I think that's the thing I want to point out here, that aside from the technical aspects in this to make this happen, we are being faced with all kinds of challenges on legal issues, which are troublesome for putting these kinds of solutions in place and make it easy. So that's the case I want to make.
First question to you. You mentioned the legal issues. Sorry, I have to look at you here. now I have the idea we see each other, yeah?
Yeah. That's how I'm also looking all the time at my screen.
Good. This is from a Dutch perspective. Do you see that, and maybe this is also a question for you, Petra, but do you see that in different countries there are different legislations whereby this is not a barrier, as you mentioned it? Richard, can you first respond on that?
Yeah, I can. I think one of the things is that in the Netherlands we have the direct line, which creates possibilities, but also has its difficulties. In other countries, these concepts are not there, but from a European European legislation says that energy communities should be a thing of the future. So energy communities should be supported by national authorities. It should be enforced. So that this, in this way, balancing or supporting grids or balancing power on a local level with a certain community of businesses that want to support each other should be possible. But the laws do not always already give room for this. But as I said, this is not only a Dutch thing. It's for ENGIE a thing which is broader. So we look at it from the ENGIE group. One of the things we really want to put forward, because these kinds of problems are all around the world. And of course, we've got our own specific Dutch situation, but similar situations are also there in France and in Belgium. But facing a different path to a solution and facing different troubles. So that's
the answer. Yeah. And Petra, do you have a different view on that?
I would not say it different. I definitely agree that the legislation these days could be a deal breaker or showstopper. But my experience or our experience talking from the economic perspective is that we were probably quite lucky in the last 4 or 5 years since we started to install these systems, is that we were mainly focusing on these remote locations, basically, since our prime core business is around the control system development for diesel gensets. The first microgrids were also built with these diesel gensets. And so this is where we get the first experience. And at that time, and even still these days, in these very remote locations, there is no legislation. And basically, there is also no legislation needed, because very often the owners or operators of the sites, they are just either the local utility, which is not connected to any broader network, and they are the rule makers themselves, or they are some mine sites, for example, or villages. And so they are very self-independent, and therefore no legislation was needed. However, I absolutely agree that when we come to on-grid microgrids, where, for example, in Europe or in some more dense locations, I mean, from the electricity point of view, dense locations, then, of course, the legislation might be the problem. And plus standardization, because there were not really many standards in the past. Everybody just tried to do his best somehow. There were, of course, some failures at the beginning. However, I think there is there are not many written standards that would be really applicable. It's just starting now. I would say since last year, we notified that somewhere already some standards are in place.
It also sounds like, Jillis, that we can learn from the remote and islands, especially in Europe, no?
Yeah, I think there are two. It's a bidirectional learning process. I think for the remote microgrids, as Petra mentioned, they are, when they grow, some legislation and regulation is required. So it might be beneficial when there's a learning from what Richard mentioned is, hey, we're seeing this development and our current legislation and regulatory framework isn't really suitable for that. So when drafting new regulation, it might be good to bring in that learning as well. One thing I was triggered about is that, Richard, you mentioned the actual title, or the working title is Local Energy Communities. Can you expand a little bit on that? Because energy, of course, is much broader than electricity.
Yes, I can. Well, in this particular site, we're primarily focusing on electricity, because heat is not really a big issue, and not also a big challenge in here. Yeah. But for what we're looking at is not single business, but multiple. So there we have the community. And then looking at the benefits that different companies can have in exchanging energy, or adapting their energy profiles, that can be in electricity, heat, but also in whatever you have, hydrogen, all kinds of energy flows and sorts. So it's really broader than this. But electricity being one of the difficult issues now with all the congestion issues we have, one of the primary focuses currently in the Netherlands.
Thank you. And of course, there's a reason for me asking you to expand a little bit on that, because I think it's an excellent bridge towards Rob. Looking at the next challenge, and as I explained a little bit in the previous session, microgrids are the next big thing, but the thing after that is the next big thing, Paul. Rob, perhaps you can expand a little bit on the next challenges of the energy transition in the industry.
Yeah, thank you. In a way, we're zooming out, or we're scaling up.
Exactly.
I think at the same time, the issues that we encounter are more or less similar on the on the different scale levels. So that's maybe a topic for discussion later. I will briefly touch on different energy vectors as well, and the interactions between them. Maybe if the slides can be started. And we'll start with an image of basically how large industrial electrification can be. Just to give you an impression, several hundreds of megawatts can easily be reached, in some cases even gigawatts, as we will we'll touch upon. Still no image. I wanted to show you an image of an electric arc furnace, which is existing technology. Also to give you a flavor that most of the technologies that we will need in the industry are already there. not always at the right scale, but it, in principle, technology is not so much of an issue. It's much more the integration, the system around it, the interaction of the technology with its system that's playing a part.
We're still waiting for your slides, but please continue.
I will. We were briefly stopping at Alphen aan den Rijn in the middle of the Netherlands. We will go a bit more south to Zeeland, to one of the industry clusters at the coast, where we will meet up with the Dow Terneuzen site and its environment. Basically, it's one of the clusters where most of the petrochemistry in the Netherlands is done, next to Rotterdam and Chemelot in the southeast. It's the largest hydrogen consumer in the Netherlands currently already. It's also one of the locations where offshore wind will be connected to the mainland. So it's energy-wise a very interesting region.
Are.
Well, this is the electric arc furnace, just to give you a bit of a hint of what electricity can do to steel. Lots of heat and lots of nice colors. We can skip to the next one directly. This is the Terneuzen site that I was talking about. Just a brief description. It's a harbor area. It's also the connection here to Antwerp. So actually, we're looking at a Dutch-Belgian industrial cluster over here. This is the Dutch part, but for instance, the ArcelorMittal site is just nearby. Refineries in Belgium and in the Netherlands are nearby. So it's really a lot of petrochemistry here, a lot of high temperature heat use. And I would like to focus now on the Dow part, the Dow chemical part of this site. So next slide can be put up, or at least next part of this slide. Yep, this one. This is what is happening over there. Part of this is already there. Part of it is future. The part that is already there is the Borssele 1 and 2 offshore wind farms. And Borssele 3 and 4 in the making. Currently installed is already 750 megawatts. Will be doubled in the next couple of years. In the middle, at the bottom, is the existing cogen unit, a gas-fired heat and power plant. It's about 400 megawatts of electricity, which is partly consumed on-site and partly delivered to the urban area nearby. And then we have the future. There's plans for several gigawatts of electrolyzer power in this region. The first gigawatt to be delivered already by 2030. There's plans further away for electrification of the naphtha crackers on site, and this would again lead to an electricity required electricity power of about a gigawatt. And then there's the elephant in the room, the missing high power line. It is under discussion, but it's not planned yet. And this is the bridge to one of the issues. But first, a bit of the environment. There's mutual interactions. Actually, you could see let's start at the basis. An industrial site can be regarded as a microgrid in itself. There's a local electricity grid which is managed normally by the site owner, but this microgrid is again embedded in the larger grid, of course. And there's plenty of interactions with these different levels. One is, for instance, that the Elsta cogen unit, if that would be shut down, and could be shut down because of market considerations, but also because of its CO2 emissions, then part of that urban area in the region would be without electricity because there's no backup in the region. So there's quite a bit of pressure on this industrial facility to keep that cogen running. At the same time, there's this offshore wind capacity, which could of course be an entry into renewables for this industrial site. So that's another interaction. And then there's the infrastructure. Electricity, like I already mentioned, but also the hydrogen infrastructure. There's existing hydrogen infrastructure here, but it's probably not enough for that gigawatts of hydrogen generation power that is coming on stream. So it is, in infrastructure-wise, a very busy region. And the current feeling is that that infrastructure will actually determine what will be built there. To give you a flavor, a cracker facility is €1 billion money. So you will only build that, or even you will only start to develop that, if you are sure that the infrastructure to connect it to is there on time. And on time would be 2035, around that year. Meaning in practice that discussions on that infrastructure have to be dealt with today. And actually the signatures have to be there very soon, otherwise this electric cracker would be delayed.
Being so many parties involved, what is the biggest barrier in that?
A very good point. I think it's indeed a multi-stakeholder issue. I think the current biggest barrier is the role of the TSO. Basically, they're mandated to invest most cost effectively. And in practice, that means they wait for the demand to be there before they invest, or at least before the demand to be sufficiently clear. In this case, an electric cracker that does not exist, not anywhere in the world, that probably will be there in 2030, 35, 2040, nobody knows, but at least the plan is 35. But it's not there. There's no investment plan yet. Of course, there's the roadmap, but it's not sufficiently solid at the moment for TenneT, in this case, the TSO, to make their investments. And one of the discussions that's currently, of course, ongoing is with the government, whether or not TenneT would be allowed to invest more upfront, take more risk. And well, as you can see from the pictures, not only that electric cracker facility, but it's also the electrolyzers in the region. There's probably plenty of demand there in the period up to 2050. Question is, will it be the specific connection to the Dow side, or will it be somewhere in the region? And I think that's also the issue. For instance, one of the things that the TSO faces is if they start their investment procedure, they need to be very sure about the exact location, the exact trajectory. They have to work on the permits, on the design. So their timeline is also quite strict. And I think, we all would benefit if the decisions would be taken as soon as possible.
Yeah. So Robert, I heard a lot of barriers, in fact. And if this would be a model for the future, I also look at you, Jelis. Yeah. What's your perspective on that? If you would use this model for Europe or Asia or...
Yeah, I think if we look at it from a somewhat broader perspective, what we see is the challenge between regulated and commercial activities. As you mentioned, we see regulated infrastructure with its own regulatory framework, its own financial schemes, and next to that we have the commercial activities, and aligning that is a real challenge. And we see that not only, as Rob mentioned, here in the Netherlands, but we see that globally. And I think Richard and Peter can also confirm that, because it's one of the drivers that commercial entities really want to move forward, want to make pace. And we see that globally, both with the rollout of renewables. If you look at the cost price of renewables, it's dropping dramatically. So it's really becoming economically viable. But the challenge is to align it with the realization of infrastructure.
Yeah.
And there's one trend you see there is that, and I think it was also mentioned during the previous session, energy as a service, is that we're not next to the existing grid and infrastructure with a connection. We now start to see developments that you actually buy energy as a service, yeah. and commercial entities take over the generation, the balancing, the conversion, the storage. And as Rob mentioned, the different energy vectors, it's not only electricity as a service, but it's really energy as a service. Mm. And so we see large commercial entities exploring that. But at the same time, we see that the regulatory framework isn't set up to really accommodate that.
Yeah. So one of the solutions could be to basically expand the commercial realm and say, optimize over that region rather than optimizing only for that specific connection to that industry side.
Yes.
That could enhance the speed of developments. But I think regulatory-wise, it would be quite difficult to go there.
That's definitely going to be a challenge. And I think, Richard, you can confirm that looking at the example you gave. Can you expand a little bit on your the issues or the discussions you've had with the regulatory and the incumbent actors in this?
I think the discussion there is a positive discussion. Let's state it in such a way. So we're all looking at this situation, and we see that there's a problem that we all want to solve, where the grid operator has no time and people to solve it quickly enough because the problems are so big. On the other hand, he also has a certain role, and I think the regulations are being made with of course from the previous century, the way the energy system worked, and so we're looking at a new world. On the other hand, we see that those grid operators are also being held by, like Rob already said, they have to have a kind of firm idea about what the grid enforcements or grid investments need to be. Otherwise, they would be spending money for nothing, which they cannot explain. So we're really looking at, can we together with these grid operators come to a solution in which we can solve the problem of these end users, these commercial businesses? And on the other hand, not create a bigger problem for these grid operators also, because that would be a possibility from these kind of connected microgrids that we could also create an even bigger problem for these grid operators, which is not the thing we want to use. We want to do. We want to make efficient use of this of the available grids and no misuse. I think that's the discussion, and a lot of the regulation is, of course, being created to make sure that misuse of the infrastructure and false investments are being prevented. From that, we are in a positive discussion, but facing difficulties in what we can do and not in what we want to do.
But if we turn that around, Richard, isn't it a opportunity for industry that they can actually influence the cost effectiveness of the grid?
Absolutely, and that's why I said it's a positive discussion. But I think from such a positive discussion, it takes some time because until we can create really commercial solutions from this. So we're now in the first phase, developing these very complex cases for solving relatively small power issues. So they're not in the gigawatt scale like Rob presented. These are in the megawatt scale, but still, these businesses need them. So we're looking into this to come up with new ideas to bring forward into the codes and into the regulations to make sure that we can solve this problem together. That's true, but we first need to look at what the shift in boundary would be between commercial and a grid operator.
Actually, I also have a question for all of you, but I'll bring them to you, Yilis. This is a positive discussion, so if these steps could be made, so what would be the future of this? Is this an enormous growth market for all of us? Is this changing our world in 5 years, or what's the perspective?
It's happening now, and the perspective is gigantic because, and I think Richard mentioned it as well, is we're doing a overhaul of our entire energy system, not only our electricity yeah. system, but our entire energy supply, and it involves. And the industry is on a pivot position yeah. In that. So, as I mentioned, it's a significant opportunity for the industry to look at their energy consumption, not only in the here and now, and as I mentioned in the first session, and as Rob mentioned right now, in the next, starting from now, but in the next decades, we really need to step up the pace. We need to transition way, way faster to be able to meet our Paris goals.
Yeah.
So the entire energy system is going to flip over. But we still have a system as it is. So we need to build from that. And looking at the way microgrids can help there is, if you see what the industry can do, not only now, but also in the next steps. And as Rob mentioned, not only look at the insides of the battery limits, the gates, but also, okay, what is my neighbor going to do? And what is the infrastructure? And what is, so expanding the scope, yeah. That can really make an impact. And as we've seen, we start from small and we can learn there. And then you can move to bigger regions. But at the same time, you should always keep in mind that, hey, in 10, 15, 20 years, some other production processes or technologies will flip over to decarbonized solutions. Mm-hmm. And how are we going to fit that in? Yeah. Because when you really want to realize that, you have to start thinking and planning and acting on it right now.
It's in fact also what you say in your story, that we have to start look forward.
Yes.
Yeah, there needs to be an adaptability in the system as well. And I think one of the things that Yilis is describing rightly is that the very nature of the energy system is changing from top down, one direction only, to multi-direction and sort of a multi-optimal solutions. And I think these industry sites are a clear reflection of that. They used to be very one-directional, feedstock and energy in and products out. And now there's energy generation on site. There's flexibility on site. There's different energy vectors, and there's energy conversion going on, and all sorts of services could be provided to the system in the future, which makes what used to be, for instance, a chemical company also makes them much more of an energy company at the same time, or at least they have the capabilities of being an energy company, and well, service companies could step in there. I think one of the challenges is really where some sort of optimum or maybe multiple optima at different scale levels, and that might change over time.
What would speed it up?
Ah, good question.
Money.
Yeah, I don't know. I think money. Well, money is abundantly available at the moment, so money is not so much of the issue. I think really the regulatory constraints are the main barrier at the moment. So some sort of room to experiment or lessening of some of the really heavy regulations would help a lot to really. Get companies to try, experiment, and do things.
Yeah. And one of the things I learned as well is that it's very difficult for companies to exchange operational data. And as Petra mentioned, the control, you have to balance generation, demand, load, conversion, storage. But exchanging data. So digitization is going to be a key driver as well, just to be aware of what everybody's consuming and where the changes, the ramp up, ramp downs mm-hmm. can be and will be. Mm-hmm. So as I mentioned in the previous session as well, the flexibility of the industrial process is going to be a key driver in that overall flexibility. Yeah. But exchanging data, exchanging information on that, it's also very difficult on the legal perspective, because you're exchanging operational data. So, for example, if a company schedules a shutdown, falls under competitive landscape.
Yeah.
So the entire energy consumption is already, but will be more and more, an integral part of your operational and cost drivers of a company.
Yeah.
So on one side, it's going to be a key resource.
Yeah.
And you want to keep that close at hand as a company, because that's where you're going to make or lose money. But at the same time, it's also a key value driver for you to be able to interact with the outside world. So that is one of the things I see as a challenge. And no company can do it alone, because you're interacting and you're interfering with your neighbor is.
Yeah.
That's a good part of it. We need to work together on this.
We really need to work and be allowed and willing to work together.
Yeah. Petra, also for you, what ideas do you have, particularly on the point Gilles is making on sharing data?
Well, I definitely agree with pretty much everything what has been said, not only
for
by
sure.
Gilles, but also Richard.
But I want solutions or ideas for solutions.
No. Well, basically, I mean, I can see that we are on a very good track, because the companies, as was said also, they are becoming now energy companies, and they are making the transition, they are making the change, because it will never be the utilities or the rule makers that will make the change from scratch. They need to be pushed by the industry, and this is what is happening. What I can see regarding the data exchange, for example, that very often companies do not even know what is their load consumption, what is their consumption of the energy. And therefore, they are not aware what are their options. And we are basically here to show them the options. And the options are many. We just need to really properly design the solution for this particular manufacturer of something or company that is producing some goods. Because the integration on different types of technologies is quite a comprehensive task. And we don't have to use all of them. We can just use few of them, which works best. So I would say that the very important part of this is really proper understanding of what the individual sites need and what actually could help them to become more, let's say, energy independent and more efficient also when it comes to operation. Because what I'm always saying is that we would solve 1/3 of this problem with power generation just by looking at the efficiency of consumption also, and by reducing our consumption, it will sort out like a number of other problems.
Yeah. So it's also about real understanding of each other. And in fact, we might need a deeper dive in cooperation. I don't know. That's maybe in the next session. I don't know. We're almost at the end of this breakout session. And I'm just going back to you, Jelis. What's your first conclusions of this first deep dive?
My first conclusion definitely is that, we need to work together and exchange information. I think already a lot of experience is identified and can be exchanged. And we see different sizes of industrial microgrids. And as Rob mentioned, experimenting, learning, gathering data, gathering information, and exchanging that, talking to each other, and identify lessons learned, either in regulatory or in data or in technology, identifying that and spread the word.
Yeah.
I think that's what we did in the previous hour. And we already identified some opportunities there.
Yeah. So. In fact, in the figure I showed you in the start, the triangle on all the three corners, we need that sharing and that cooperation.